seeing everybody. Nice big crowd, which is appreciated. Welcome to the Urban Institute Women Seminar. Great privilege to introduce a longtime friend and colleague to many of us in the bioethics and Urban Institute community, Professor Hildy Lindemann Nelson, who I didn't realize until today had become an emerita professor. For many years taught at Michigan State University in the Department of Philosophy, where you still retain an associate status, right? She left the cold white north, I think probably still is the case this time of year, for warmer climates in Knoxville, Tennessee, which is a place where she once was on the faculty at the University of Tennessee, and where she has, most importantly, grandchildren. She also has children there. But more important to have grandchildren than children. My mother likes to remind me. So it's really a small joke. So a really wonderful pleasure and privilege to have Hildy here. We were trying to figure out, I've known you, it seems like, as long as I've been in bioethics forever, truly enough, and there are many people here who could say the same thing. Hildy's contributions really are many and varied. Lots of work related to patients and families, I would say. And apropos of that, Professor Nelson will speak today on why families matter. So please join me in welcoming Professor Hildy Lindemann Nelson.
Although y'all have got a northern winter going on just at the moment, and I want to know what you mean by it. But I want to talk, this is one of my favorite things to talk about why families matter. Now, that treatment decisions are not always guided by what's in the medical best interests of a pediatric patient is not in doubt. Consider the very badly damaged neonate, whose parents painfully decide they must not consent to a costly course of treatments involving repeated hospitalizations that might prolong the infant's life another year or two because they live a half day's journey from the hospital and they have three other young children at home. Such decisions have been defended by appeals to justice. John Hardwick, for example, has argued that a patient's right to treatment is circumscribed, like all rights, by the harm that it inflicts on others, in this case, the child's parents. Considerations aside from justice would also motivate the thought that important interests of individual parents or siblings or grandparents or just spouses, anybody, may override the interests of the patient. But this focus on what is owed to individual family members obscures attention to what is owed to families, considered not merely as the sum total of the individuals within them, but as morally valuable entities in themselves. I'm not getting this clear, right? While there's little enough mention in the bioethics literature of the husbands, wives, parents, or grown children of patients, except perhaps as proxy decision makers or informal caregivers, almost nothing has been written about the moral relationship between families themselves and medicine. I find the exclusion of the family's perspective from healthcare ethics peculiar, very widespread, and in need of remedy. Accordingly, in this talk, I offer some theoretical underpinnings for the idea that familial considerations must be taken into account in medical decision making, and that sometimes these considerations have a greater claim on healthcare professionals than do the best interests of the patient. I'm going to start by identifying morally valuable functions that families perform for their own. Then I'm going to consider what is of intrinsic value. Families. And finally, I'll argue that a family's ability to provide these goods, and indeed its very existence, can be put at risk when too many demands, or the wrong kind of demands, are made on it. Families come in many configurations and sizes, and the term means different things in different contexts. What I mean by here is the structure of intimacy in which most people live out their lives, characterized by relationships that are more or less ongoing and close, usually, but not always, involving long periods of living together in the same household. Ordinarily, but not always, they're structures of love and trust. Although even when these are absent, the vulnerability produced by the intimacy within them gives them rise to special responsibilities of care, consideration, and commitment. So in other words, I'm going to use family the way we ordinarily do. Now, on a liberal view of persons as free, autonomous individuals, it could be assumed that families are nothing more than the sum of their individual members, and that they have no identity apart from that. I'm going to argue the contrary. Families are social institutions with their own histories, features, and functions. Ferdinand Schumann calls the family an intimate arrangement having its own goals and purposes, an organic and enduring entity. And it's all of that. Families endure by shape-shifting. People are born into and die out of them, abandon them, enter them by marriage or other long-term commitments, such as adoption, and reconfigure them by things like divorce and remarriage. But while families change shape over time, they also have their own distinctive characteristics. A family might, for example, be Amish or Roman Catholic, even though not everybody in the family fits that description. Might be working class or wealthy, descended from the Mayflower or Boston Irish. Some families produce athletes in every generation. Others tend for the arts. Some have a strong work ethic. Still others are blended or interracial or queer or farm or refugee. But it could still be objected that family is simply shorthand for the web of interrelationships among the individuals who form one, valued only insofar as the people in them are valued. But sometimes it seems we act for the sake of the family even when we don't value some of the individuals in it. And here's where I tell my own story. When I was 18, my father apparently decided it was time for the lecture on be careful whom you marry. And he did this by telling me of his two previous marriages, which none of us children knew had existed. So that was for one thing. And he was born in 1900. And he said he married his first wife, a very pretty blonde woman, when he was in his 20s. And I've never been able to say this without laughing. She ran away with a candy salesman from Ohio. Then he married his second wife in the 1930s in Austria. He used to go to Austria or Germany every summer. And he met her there, fell passionately in love, married her, and brought her to the United States. Now, because she couldn't speak any English and his mother was a German immigrant, he brought his mother into the household, which I could have told him was a bad mistake because she was a battle axe anyway. So he got home one day to a darkened living room and his mother sobbing, saying that his wife had thrown a plate at her. So he started investigating. He wrote to his friends in Austria and soon found out that her father was in a home for inebriates and her mother was in a mental institution. He decided he did not want to have children by such a woman. So he put her on the next boat back to Austria in 1938.
Oh.
Yeah. And she was pregnant at the time. My father was not a nice man, really. So these were the warnings I was supposed to get. And the reason I bring it up is that I don't know anything about the child except that my father paid $100 maintenance for her 1 year. And that's probably when it stopped because of the war. And her name is Ursula. But I would now And I expect many of you have the same intuition. If she came knocking on my door and said she was my half-sister, I would invite her in and at least offer her hospitality, and maybe more than that. So why would I do that? Because she's family. So, the family that matters in a medical context is that of the patient. And for a pediatric patient, this would paradigmatically consist of the child's biological mother, father, and siblings, but it might not. Many children live in single-parent families or adoptive or foster families. Others live with a grandmother or aunt or perhaps cousins. Still others live in reconfigured families with a biological parent, step-siblings, with or without visits to the other biological parent. However that may be, from the time of the child's birth, the family performs a number of crucial functions in the child's life. Your families, when you were little, also performed these functions. And what follows is by no means an exhaustive list, but it serves as a reminder of why families are instrumentally valuable. First and most obviously, families are responsible for preserving the child's life. This duty comprises not only feeding, clothing, and sheltering the child, but also keeping her from harm. Parents or other adults in the role of parents must provide as secure an environment as their resources allow, which includes, among other things, teaching older siblings to be gentle with the baby, making sure the child's immunizations are up to date, fastening the child's seatbelt if the family has access to a car, taking her to the doctor when she's ill. Siblings must keep sharp implements away from the child, refrain from slamming doors in her face or involving her in dangerous play, protect her from neighborhood bullies, and keep her from running out into the street. So it's not just the parents who are doing the work of nurture. Second, and this is also obvious but often overlooked, the family is the foundry in which the child's identity is forged. It's the family that establishes a proto-identity for her before she's even born. She's Candle Smith, daughter of June Smith and Maria Garcia, little sister to Carlos, native of North Carolina. These and other important facts about her are woven into the stories and fragments of stories that parents, siblings, and other family members create or draw on to depict the child as she grows and changes over time. And it's that narrative tissue that constitutes the child's identity. As the child acquires a self and then becomes self-aware, third-person stories that were all the identity she originally had are gradually augmented by the first-person stories that constitute her own sense of who she is. But this probably doesn't happen until she's at least between 3 and 6 years old. Before then, those who are intimately connected to her both construct her identity and then maintain it, hold her in it, by treating her according to their narrative sense of her. While many people hold us in our identities, the ongoing intimacy of families makes them particularly well suited to perform this function for their own. That's why when Carlos teases little Candle until she cries, or Maria is laid off from a job that has been important to her self-conception, or June is suffering from a serious illness that loosens her grip on herself, they look to the others in the family to reassure them as to who they really are. A third function of families is socializing children. Consider what this involves. It includes teaching them to talk, walk, feed, and dress themselves and interact in a civilized manner with others. I'm ahead of myself again. But it's also a matter of giving children their second nature and thereby initiating them into a specific form of life. Second nature, as Aristotle understood it, is human nature. The disposition to virtue instilled in us on top of our animal nature through good upbringing so that we are fit to take our place in human society. Now, where Aristotle thought of it largely as moral formation, for John McDowell, Second nature also comprises our disposition to rationality. To acquire second nature is to acquire the concepts that let us connect our minds to the world. Because of our second nature, we can simultaneously be of the world and know the world, acting in it according to the moral and other reasons that are there. Now, like McDowell, I believe that an absolutely central element in the acquisition of our second nature is learning language. It's in speaking to children, singing, commanding, explaining, making jokes, employing sarcasm, and as Wittgenstein says, requesting, thanking, cursing, greeting, praying, that families not only open the gates for children to the rational and moral world, but also show them what to do when they get inside. Stanley Cavell explains what we learn along with language acquisition in this way. When you say, I love my love, the child may learn the meaning of the word love and what love is, i.e. that what you do will be love in the child's world. And if it's mixed with resentment and intimidation, then love is a mixture of resentment and intimidation for that child. And when love is sought, that will be sought. When you say, I'll take you tomorrow, I promise, the child begins to learn what temporal durations are and what trust is. And what you do will show what trust is worth. When you say, put on your sweater, the child learns what commands are and what authority is. And if giving orders is something that creates anxiety for you, then authorities are anxious, authority itself uncertain. Of course, hopefully the person growing will learn other things about those concepts and objects also. They will grow gradually as the child's world grows. So acquisition of language is also the initiation into how we do things, a particular culture's socially shared behavior and ways of understanding. For as we learn language, we also learn shared roots of interest and feeling, modes of response, senses of humor and of significance and of fulfillment, of what is outrageous, of what is similar to what else, what a rebuke, what forgiveness, of when an utterance is an assertion, when an appeal, when an explanation, all the world organism Wittgenstein calls forms of life. And again, I'm quoting Cavell. It's as it's a child's family that initiates her into language, with all that that entails, we can see that her family gives her not only herself, but her world. A fourth function of families is to nurture its members. This is a matter of giving the emotional, intellectual, and spiritual support that allows them to live well. A good husband, for instance, nurtures his wife by coming to hear her first solo performance with the church choir. Good siblings nurture with financial assistance and perhaps shelter when a grown sister or brother needs help exiting an abusive relationship. The nurture of the young proceeds on much the same lines. The child's parents, siblings, grandparents, and other intimates encourage her to try new things, affirm her curiosity and creativity, help her overcome her fears, nourish her imagination, and give her hope. A fifth function of families is to nurse its members when they're ill, joining forces with healthcare professionals when the illness is too serious for home remedies. When a child is nursed at home, siblings participate in giving the needed care. They bring daddy the bottle of Tylenol or cough syrup, find and start the child's favorite movie, wake mama in the middle of the night when the child gets thrown up. Grandparents or other family members who aren't part of the household are often recruited as informal caregivers as well, especially when the child's parent or parents must be away for large parts of the day. When the child is hospitalized for a lengthy period of time, however, it's the parents alone who divide the responsibility for the child's care to health professionals. that parents are visible to the healthcare team while the rest of the family is receded into the background may account in part for the relative inattention to the family as a whole in the bioethics literature. So if, as this partial list of familial functions suggests, families are valuable for what they can do for us, they're also valuable for what they are in themselves. What follows is not meant to be exhaustive, but rather to serve as a reminder, something you all really know if you think about it, of what good enough, imperfect families are actually like. First, families are places of love. It's often said that people need love just as much as they need food, clothing, and the other goods and services that families provide. So it might be thought that love makes families instrumentally, not inherently valuable. But that's to mistake the nature of love. Think about it. It's not a service like clean clothes in a drawer or a good like a hot dinner. Rather, it's a specific kind of interpersonal connection. When a child is an infant, the connection is one-sided. The parents give and the child receives. But what they give is themselves. They open their hearts and lives to the child, offering it the best of who they are. It's an invitation which, if the connection is to remain loving, rather than degenerating into exploitation, must be reciprocated as soon as the child is old enough. Otherwise, the child is simply using the parents for what she can get. As the child grows, those in the family who love her teach her how to love them back, until in time she learns to love maturely. Because family connections are human, the love that informs them is always mixed with less desirable elements, selfishness, inattention, domination, fear, indifference, anger. Nevertheless, love is prized and sought after for its own sake. And that much of it is to be found in families is a partial explanation of their inherent value. Second, families are also the site where lives are shared. The activities, routines, and events that are the stuff of family life tie its members together in an ongoing history that's common to all, though each person experiences it differently. What happens to one affects the others, particularly the children who are entirely dependent on the rest. Indeed, the intertwining of lives is essential to the identity formation and maintenance that goes on in families. It's the people you share your life with who are most often directly implicated in the important acts, experiences, roles, relationships, characteristics, and commitments around which everybody's identity-constituting stories are woven. And that's part of the reason why those people are so important to you. For better or worse, in good enough families, the sense of security that comes from knowing that we do not navigate this world alone can be worth a great deal. We value the ability to share our lives themselves, and we find it tragic when a person can't do that. Because identities are part of what we value, we value people, and these are bound up with the people whose lives we share, that sharing itself is inherently valuable. Third, as they live out their lives together, family members encumber each other with a thick conception of the good, a specific understanding of what makes life worthwhile. It's important not to romanticize this. The family might live by a code of honor that requires avenging any insult, no matter how slight, or protecting the purity of female members by sequestering them. That's a danger that can't be helped, though. Wherever there's enduring intimacy, there will be value-infused outlooks, attitudes, priorities, and ways of proceeding that are shared in common and that give a specific shape to the family member's life. These thick conceptions of the good are necessary for what Charles Taylor calls strong evaluation, evaluations that involve discrimination of right or wrong, better or worse, higher or lower, which are not rendered valid by our own desires, inclinations, or choices, but rather stand independent of these and offer standards by which they can be judged. Now, Taylor links strong evaluation to the formation of second-order volition. That's what philosophers call the ability that we have to reflect on our first-order desires and determine whether we find them worthy of moving us to action. The power to regulate our first-hour desires in this way, according to Harry Frankfurt, is what frees our will. Otherwise, if we can't do that, we're wantons, he says. But if we can exercise second-order volition, then it's we ourselves and not our desires that determine what we want to do. The weak evaluator, whose will is not free, evaluates her first-order desires and chooses the one that produces the most immediate satisfaction. The child wants the Star Wars Legos for her birthday, but also the Iron Man costume, and picks the Legos because she thinks they'll be more fun. She takes her desires for granted, and they are what move her to action. The strong evaluator, by contrast, understands that her desires themselves can be evaluated in terms of their worth, and endorses or repudiates them with the aim of making herself into a morally good person. This is the person who decides whether she wants to want something. The adult who once played Star Wars and Iron Man reflects on the institutionalized sexist violence that pervades her society and does not want to be the kind of person who's complicit in that in any way, especially not as a form of entertainment. So she judges her desire to play Grand Theft Auto to be unworthy of her and goes bowling instead. If Taylor is right, adults engage the values that inhere in their conception of the good not only to regulate their first order desires, but to strengthen their moral character. For a child to learn how to do this, she must make use of such conceptions of the good as are available to her, namely, those of her family. That's why it matters that families encumber each other with their own sense of what's valuable. In opening the family members up to the range of values that are found in the world, families are the condition for the possibility of their members' agency. And as that agency is valued for itself, so are the conditions it. And fourth, a family is a child's home. Every person's home. And as that, it's the security and stability that grounds the person's life. Again, it's important not to romanticize this. In concrete practice, alcoholism, parental death or abandonment, serious illness, domestic violence, constant fighting, sexual abuse, and other evils can make a nightmare of a home. Idealized, the notion of home has often been insufferably petty bourgeois and oppressive of women. But Iris Marion Young, among others, has defended home as, and I'm quoting, the material anchor for a sense of agency and a shifting and fluid identity. An anchor that's particularly necessary for the rapidly growing and changing child. Home surrounds us with the objects, artifacts, rituals, and practices that configure who we are in our individuality and give context to our lives. To be sure, for Young, home is conceptually distinct from family, as it also includes the domestic space inhabited by individuals living on their own. But for children, home and family are one. For them, home consists of the family that makes the domestic space the child's own. Family members do it when they care for their possessions and transmit the value of that care to the younger generation. They do it when they look after and love one another in that place. They do it when they use that place for the daily routines, familiar rituals, and special celebrations that affirm that identity as a family. It's these people that Robert Frost had in mind when he wrote, "Home is the place where, when you have to go there, they have to take you in. They have to, because you belong there. You're one of them." When the child is old enough to make a new home for herself, home and family are no longer coextensive. But then, perhaps especially in times of need and dependency, home is still her family. However it may reconfigure being are inherently valuable, their ground is too. It's always difficult to make a case for a thing's inherent value, and I can't hope to persuade everybody that families should be valued in this way. I think they should, but even if I'm wrong, it's enough for the purposes of my argument if I've shown that they possess instrumental value, because that alone gives us reason to care for them and keep them safe from harm. Serious illness puts pressure not only on individual family members, but also on the family itself. The care of an acutely ill family member requires the family to channel many of its resources toward a single person, an arrangement that can usually be sustained for a while, but it can't be continued indefinitely, what the other members do without. Illness disrupts ordinary familial functions, and if it's serious enough, it threatens to break the family altogether. When a person is gravely ill, the familial function of nursing is ordinarily turned over to health professionals, which means that families no longer have primary control over how it's done. Yet some of that care cannot be provided in the same way by even the most attentive professional staff, precisely because the staff aren't part of the family. It's one thing when a hospital nurse gives medication that makes the pain go away, and quite another when my spouse does it at home, as my spouse transmits the comfort of love, familiarity, and connection along with the dose. The inability to give familial care in a hospital setting, even when the family recognizes the need for professional help and is grateful for it, may leave family members feeling helpless and at a loss, frustrated by not being able to do what they do best. It's not only the nursing function that's disrupted in times of illness. When parents must spend every moment at the hospital, children or frail elderly relatives may find themselves less well protected than they are in happier times. They may be frightened by the long absences, unsettled by the change in their routines, less well supervised by people not thoroughly familiar with their needs and proclivities, more prone to engage in dangerous activities. At the same time, the parents may feel guilty that they can't be at home, worried about their other children's well-being, and frustrated by their inability to look after the frail elders who need them. Grandparents, aunts, and uncles, or family friends can go some distance toward taking the parent's place at home, but unlike professional caregivers who can be replaced by equally qualified others, family members are not interchangeable, as children in particular know only too well. Identity maintenance also undergoes a special strain when a person is hospitalized for a long period of time. If the patient is a baby, the family's function of creating her identity is disrupted when the infant is torn from the nest of relationships in which this work takes place. If she's an adult, her sense of herself may be threatened, first by her illness and then by her isolation from the familial intimates who hold her in her identity. And nor is she likely to be the only one who faces difficulties here. Other family members might find their own identities under siege because they can't perform their roles in the usual way. Stress, worry, and sleeplessness can contribute to their sense of inadequacy or anger and reduce their ability to maintain either their own or their loved one's identities. And once again, those at home may be less able to cope and find that their grip on themselves is weakened. Serious illness likewise retards socialization and nurturing. The pediatric patient may be slow to muster the linguistic and social skills of healthy children her age, or be emotionally immature or destructively self-centered. Siblings may pick up on tensions in the home and regress on some or all fronts. And as money and time may be scarcer than usual, middle-class families may be forced to curtail music lessons or soccer practice, while low-income families might have to do without decent food, clothing, or health care. All that's bad enough, but health professionals and medical ethicists do not understand well the relationship between families and medical ethicists who do not understand well the relationship between families and medicine can make matters even worse. For example, ventilator care or dialysis thrust family members with no medical training into positions of serious responsibility. When a baby born at 25 weeks gestation is discharged from the NICU that has saved her life but left her with serious damage to lungs and brain, neonatologists may take it for granted that her family will provide years of unrelenting care that will now be required. Parents may be called out to learn how to insert a nasogastric tube or perform high-frequency chest wall oscillation or to devote significant amounts of time providing physiotherapy. And if a kidney or liver lobe is required, healthcare providers may assume that family members will just naturally volunteer. This cavalier attitude toward families is arguably born of nothing worse than misunderstanding or forgetting what families are for. Another, more pernicious attitude arises out of the clash between healthcare ethics, which is patient-centered and individualistic, and the ethics of families, which is neither. In families where the universe is much more communal and relational, people will sometimes behave in ways that, from a professional, patient-centered perspective, may seem flat-out immoral. And medical ethicists, trained in the impartialist, individualist moral theories originally designed to govern interactions in the public sphere, have been deeply suspicious of families as well. As a result, there is what amounts to a default setting of distrust, a presumption on the part of clinicians and bioethicists that a family is just as likely as not to be neglectful, abusive, or selfish. A wife's decision not to visit her husband every day because her energy and attention are also required at home can be seen by the staff as callous or possibly even neglectful. A parent's insistence that a protesting child participate in a clinical trial by giving blood can be seen by the ethicist as abusive rather than as holding the child to the family's conception of the good. Parents' requests for growth attenuation therapy for a profoundly impaired child can be construed by health professionals as a demand that the child's bodily integrity be violated solely because the family is too lazy and selfish to provide respectful care, rather than recognizing that it would enhance the child's participation in family life. It's not that families should always prevail in these disputes. My point is only that the expression of a distinct family-oriented perspective strikes many professional caregivers as illegitimate, as undermining familial claims to care. Such distrust can add to the strain families are already under, posing a threat to their identities. It can call into question everything that's inherently valuable about them, cast doubt on how well they love, whether the lives in them are exploited rather than shared, whether their conception of the good is good enough, and how adequately they function as a home. When coupled with greatly heightened demands on families' capacity for care, this attitude on the part of clinicians, as bolstered by medical ethicists, can damage families' own sense of why they are, of what they are, and why that matters. Like the people within them, families under pressure need to be held in their identities by caring others who recognize what is valuable about them and treat them on the basis of that recognition. Otherwise, they're at risk of losing their integrity, perhaps to the point where they cease to be families at all. We medical ethicists may be forgiven for not having developed a robust account of the moral interface between families and medicine, although I'm working on it. The moral theories on which we standardly draw aren't particularly well equipped to handle relations of intimacy and dependence. And while almost all of us have families of our own, we mostly just appreciate them without stopping to think very much about why that's so. In this talk, I've only been able to provide the merest sketch of the sort of things about families that matter. But I've also tried to show why we all, ethicists and clinicians alike, might need to take family members more seriously. What's at stake is the well-being not only of our sickest family members, but the webs of love and and connection in which they live. Thank you for being so kind.
Thank you, Hillary. Really interesting. So we need to have people raise their hand, and Pete has a microphone. Remember to wait for the mic so that we capture your question for the video. So if you want to come up here, I think we have Holly and Deborah.
I think that was lovely. I wanted to follow up on a point that resonated towards the end about understanding. So for example, a healthcare provider, some work I'm doing, a healthcare provider may be asking a spouse, in most cases, to facilitate an event of their spouse who has cognitive challenges.
Right.
And the group has to rely on the fully functioning spouse for quite a bit. And we found that they don't really understand all the things that person takes on. And I'm wondering, you sort of alluded to how you're thinking about this, but is it one step might be just raising that level of understanding among the healthcare providers, but do you have something else in mind in order to fill that out?
Yeah, raising the level of understanding, but also making it possible for the healthcare provider to care about the patient, to love the patient. And sometimes you can do that with family photographs or some hobby that the ill family member has that the healthcare provider also has. The idea is to make connection as well as to provide understanding, I think.
Thank you so much. That was a great talk, and I hope you're going to publish it so that I can cite it. I have certainly found much of what you said to be true, both personally, but also in some research I'm doing in a particular medical care context, which is genetic testing.
Right.
Where, of course, the data that come out of this testing are
oh, bless you for
data.
Using data as a plural noun. Oh, you get lots of
English
credit for that.
In college.
Okay, that totally distracted me from your question.
So we've been doing interviews with individuals who have pre-symptomatic genetic testing for Huntington's disease, and we haven't finished thoroughly analyzed the data at all yet. But it seems that when we ask people general questions about the effects of this kind of testing, the majority of their answers relate to effects on their families, not effects on them personally.
Right.
But
right, that's interesting.
And especially in the context of genetic testing, we have no way to account for family members. So for example, if I enroll someone in a trial where they're getting genetic testing, that person maybe is a patient here and has an Epic record. Their family's genetic information is important, but there's no place to put that. Like we structurally,
yeah.
Not just
yes.
Educationally
yes.
or normatively, but structurally,
yes.
We have no way of taking account of the family either.
That's right. And often hospitals do have to change either their structures or their practices mm-hmm. to accommodate families. And it seems to me in genetic testing, you better be able to come up with a way for that to happen. Go see your dean immediately.
Thank you. I'm a clinician. I'm a pediatric endocrinologist, and I'm curious your thoughts about family-centered care. If you think that's just a title, or if it attains some of the lofty goals that you discussed today.
I don't think the goals are so lofty, they're just common sense. But yeah, family-centered care is desirable not only with pediatricians, where you do find it quite a lot, but also throughout the hospital, I would think. Families sometimes have to manage kids' diabetes, and then say it's a teenager, and the teenager may not even want to have anything to do with his family, but he might listen to a good friend. So for those purposes, the friend counts as family, and you bring them in and help work with them. And that goes throughout the lifespan, I think. I guess what I'm hoping is that people will, that healthcare professionals in particular, will see that there is this difference in the ethics between healthcare and families, and not just assume that families should know healthcare ethics, because why the hell should they? You know, that doesn't make sense. So it's up to health professionals who have grown up in families to realize that that's what families are doing. And that is a large part of family-centered care, I think.
Thank you.
Hi, Gilbert Prasad from the faculty member of the Berman Institute. So I was interested in the role that inherent value was playing in the presentation. I was curious about why it mattered that family had inherent value as opposed to instrumental value. So mightn't instrumental value be enough for family to matter quite a bit? And I thought that the way that the inherent value principle was presented in the discussion of being at home, struck me as surprising, because it didn't generally follow that if something is the ground of something with inherent value, that it's thereby inherently valuable. So you might say that somebody with a pacemaker, for instance, the pacemaker maintains her agency, her capacity for curing all kinds of things. But that doesn't make the pacemaker inherently valuable.
No, that's right. And it goes the other way around, too. But with families, why it matters, why inherent value matters, is that families are sites not only of home, but of a particular kind of intimacy, the long-term intimacy. And that it's where, in particular, we're held in our identities. And so it seems to me that is inherent value, that it's so valuable that we can't replace it with another instrument, say, or with another social configuration. If you don't want to think of them as inherently valuable, that's fine, even I guess, because I'm already making the point just with the instrumental value. But I think there's more than that. With my half-sister Ursula, because she's family. Why does that matter? It matters inherently.
Wonderful, Bobby Kilby. So you gave us a lot to think about in terms of our own appraisal of families functioning and decision making. And you mentioned at one point, which really resonates with the clinical experience, is that families are trying to find a place of integrity in the midst of everything that they're doing, to see themselves in some way as fulfilling their role as a parent. So how do we begin to assess the diversity and variability of our understandings of family in the context of our clinical work, where the question of what is a good enough family comes up constantly?
Of course it does. That's an excellent question, Cinda, and I wish I could answer it. I guess a partial answer is the first thing that clinicians could do is trust people. Not just assume that family members are being abusive because they want everything done and the clinicians don't think, you know, that should be the goal anymore, because the family might be vitalists or something. So that it wouldn't be abusive, it's just a different way of thinking about life. Also, in social care terms, I wish children weren't so quickly put into social care when there's anything wrong in a family. So that may not be necessary, and it's a terrible thing to do to a child. So along those lines, I'd say trust is the one thing. And again, make connections wherever you can. And sometimes change the structure of how things are done. That can be helpful too. You fill in the blank now.
So actually my comment is very much like Cindy's. Mom Thompson, I'm the child protection team coordinator for pediatrics at the hospital. And I think one of the daily conflicts that occurs is for medical providers trying to understand, and this is even with us being rooted in the idea of family-centered care, but trying to understand that the care that they're recommending is idealized. No, it's basic. It's this is just what is needed. That medical care is almost inherently idealized compared to what is a good enough family. And so I really appreciated you incorporating that into the presentation, that family, not in all instances, but I would say almost in the majority, are what is good enough for the child in that moment. And that good enough does not necessarily equal ideal. It may be ideal for me, but that doesn't mean it's idealized in the same way that I can provide 24-hour care for my trach-vented neonate. That is a great example. But even with maintaining routine medical care, getting to all of your immunizations exactly on time, whatever. And so, again, mostly just a thank you for incorporating that concept, because it is very easy for providers to forget the inherent value that a family presents.
Yeah.
And a thousand ways beyond the day-to-day medical care.
I think that's a valuable comment, and I also think it can be, it works the other way around too. Families often idealize medical care.
Yeah.
And then they have these wild expectations, and they are so disappointed in their doctors. Mostly they like their GPs, but all other doctors are suspect because they aren't on call 24 hours, 7 days a week, performing miracles. And so families can use a little bit of, education is not the word here. I think it's more, again, connection, trust, understanding that it's not going to be all roses.
David, go ahead.
This is a wonderful presentation, very insightful and thought-provoking. You use the term family in a sort of monolithic way, and yet all of us who work with families know that there are conflicts within the families.
Of course.
And I'm curious about your approach to resolving or dealing with conflicts when family members don't agree or are unhappy and maybe can't even find the words to express their unhappiness. But
yeah,
it's a real issue.
This is a chronic problem for clinicians, because it's often the case when, say, an elderly parent is hospitalized and can't speak for himself anymore, and the children disagree violently sometimes about what should be done. Ethicists can be helpful there sometimes, not by laying down the moral law, but by trying to get people to communicate with each other, trying to find connections among them, trying to see where there is common ground that they might be able to build on, things like that. Sometimes it helps just to have one spokesperson from the family, but then you get quarrels about who should be the spokesperson. So that doesn't always work either. And sometimes you just have to say, all right, if you all can't agree, then we'll have to, after we tried a lot to resolve the differences here, we'll have to do it the way we think is best. And I hate that, because short-circuiting the family can cause problems for years down the road. But sometimes that's all that's left, as you know.
Alexis.
Hi, thanks so much for your talk. I'm Alexis Walker. I'm a postdoc in the Berman Institute. So you warned that we shouldn't idealize families,
right,
but it also seems that you are focusing on perhaps erring on the side of trust for clinicians and trusting in families. And I wondered if you could speak a bit to how, you know, the concerns that you mentioned about, for example, you mentioned specifically the petite bourgeois notions of the family. Those are, you know, real concerns about how what those models do to us socially and also context of abuse, et cetera. So how do those things that are real concerns then function into what you're speaking about?
Well, I don't think it's clinicians' job to right all the familial wrongs. That's not possible anyway. It's good to recognize them. And all I'm asking is that we not leap to the abuse default so readily, that we make a different default of trust unless we have reason not to trust. And surely there are times not to trust families. There are cases of abuse, very frequent ones involve domestic abuse, which is usually a woman being beaten up by her partner. And she doesn't want to press charges. And so the hospital has to keep treating this woman over and over again for broken bones or cracked ribs and things like that. And then social work has to get involved because it's really more their domain than yours. No, I don't want to romanticize families at all. Sometimes even it's kids who do the abusing, little kids who will abuse their siblings. And, you know, it's an imperfect world, is all I can say about that. We can't expect, we shouldn't have idealistic notions about families any more than we do about medicine. And I'm sorry, that's really about all I can do.
Okay, one last question from Sam.
Thanks for the talk.
Hi, Sam.
So I was very convinced, but I was trying to think, I guess I was thinking about kids and times when they might disagree with their family members. I was thinking about access to birth control, for example, or other issues too. And I was thinking, for some people, it might be the case that knowing that the default when they see a doctor or other medical professional is not going to have anything to do with their family necessarily. Here's a place I can go where it's all about me. It's something that is kind of comforting, kind of refuge.
Yes.
So I wonder how you balance that ideal with these more family-focused ideals that you laid out in the talk.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing about families is they can be so dominating that people get smothered or oppressed. And again, clinicians can notice that. They can provide the kind of isolation that you're talking about, the solitude that the patient needs. But that's, again, really about all they can do. The family is what it is, and it's not going to change. So all that can change is the patient's and care provider's response to it. And that's pretty limited what the care providers can do. I can't think of anything except sort of bodily removing the patient, providing longer hospital stays, for example, that are strictly necessary and things like that. But the rest of it's really up to the patient to figure out what her response is going to be and to try and carry that through. And that often involves therapy, sometimes years and years of therapy. Hope that was a good enough answer.